SpaceX's prized test site, Massey, looked like a battlefield. Not a single ship stood in the launch pad. Not a single engine fired. Just twisted pipes, charred metal, and silence. Ship 36 had just turned into a fireball, and suddenly the biggest rocket program in the world was stuck. But SpaceX doesn't stay stuck for long, because while the rest of the world thought they'd go quiet, Elon's team was already sketching new plans on whiteboards. If Massey couldn't run ship static fires, they'd have to get creative. And they did. What they came up with? It might just be the most insane workaround Starbase has ever seen. They're probably preparing to static fire a Starship directly from the orbital launch mount. To pull this off, they rolled out a massive ship work stand in the dead of the night. They've got the 6 clamps needed to hold a Starship in place. They've got a spare QD plate just sitting at Sanchez. It connects power, fuel, and data to the ship. Normally, this would be a backup. Now it might become the lifeline of a new testing system. The plan is to weld or bolt the stand onto the launch mount, attach the ship, modify the quick disconnect arm to reach and support the ship's systems. It's like rigging a commercial airplane to fire up its engines on top of a launch tower. Wild. Risky. But if anyone's going to do it, it's SpaceX. Why take the gamble? Because the timeline is brutal. The next Mars transfer window opens in a little over a year. That's the moment when Earth and Mars align for an efficient trip. If they miss it, they wait another 26 months. And in Elon's world, waiting is not an option. And then there's Massey. On the ground, it looks like a war zone. Trees around the test pad have turned brown, burnt from the heat wave. Metal debris is scattered across the site. Workers are back, slowly checking on the pistons and welds of test tank 18.1. But the big repairs haven't started. And that's the problem. Because as long as Massey is out of commission, testing for ships like 37 and 39 gets bottlenecked, and if they can't test, they can't launch. This is why the new adapter plan matters. If it works, they won't just save time. So now the question is, will they actually fire a Starship without a booster? Or will this bold idea turn into yet another explosion waiting to happen? We'll find out soon, but for now, let's take a moment to salute the real heroes who truly deserve it. Most people know the name Elon Musk, but what if I told you the real backbone of SpaceX is a team of lesser-known warriors? People who don't tweet much. People who don't take center stage. But without them, the rockets don't fly. Company doesn't breathe. Let's start with the calm force behind the chaos, Gwynne Shotwell. She was employee number 11. Not an engineer, not a coder. But the reason SpaceX didn't crash and burn in its early days. She took the calls, closed the deals, read the fine print. Back in 2008, when SpaceX desperately needed a break, she helped lock in a life-saving NASA contract. That deal didn't just fund Falcon rockets, it put SpaceX on the map. Today, she's not just the president and chief operating officer, she's also a billionaire in her own right. Her eyes are always on the next launch, but her feet are firmly on the ground. But even she would tell you, no one does this alone. Tim Hughes stepped in back in 2005. At the time, he was just a lawyer with deep Washington roots, but he'd already seen disaster up close, helping shape safety laws after the Columbia shuttle tragedy. At SpaceX, he became the bridge between bold vision and cold government policy. The man could sit in a Senate hearing and make rockets sound like common sense. Today, he runs global business and government affairs, navigating politics like turbulence. Money, risk, survival. That's where Brett Johnson comes in. Brett didn't walk into rockets from a love of space. He came from Broadcom, from spreadsheets and shareholder meetings. But SpaceX needed that. In 2011, when he joined, the company was moving fast, but the financial engine needed discipline. He brought that. Today, as chief financial officer and head of strategic acquisitions, he's the guy who makes sure SpaceX can dream big and afford it. Each one of them has faced failure. Some have cried over setbacks. Some have gone days without sleep before a test flight. But none of them stop. On the other hand, Blue Origin's New Glenn is preparing for its second launch attempt. The debut flight has already happened, quietly, off the radar for many, but now all eyes are on the next chapter. In April, Blue Origin fired up New Glenn's second stage in a test, a vital step. This part of the rocket gives the final push to orbit. Think of it like the second wind in a marathon runner. Without it, the mission falls flat. Two sources now say the first stage is nearly ready in Cape Canaveral. The timeline keeps shifting. Publicly, Blue Origin had aimed for August 15th, but that's no longer happening. Internally, some believe mid-September is possible, others say October, or even November. And yet, something curious is happening. If launched this fall, Mission Escapade won't reach Mars until late 2027. That's 2 years later than planned, but it's still alive. After this, Blue Origin has a rough sketch of missions lined up. Firefly's Elytra transfer vehicle, a cluster of Amazon's internet satellites, but nothing's locked in. Rockets, after all, are like jazz. There's a plan, but you've got to be ready to improvise. And then there's one everyone's watching for, the Blue Moon Mark I lander. 8 meters tall, sleek, towering, and bold. It's already being assembled in Rocket Park, Florida. This is the cargo version, Mark I. Its bigger sibling, Mark II, is meant to carry humans. But Mark I alone can land 3 metric tons on the moon's surface, 10 times more than any current lander. If nothing breaks down, Mark I might just touch the moon before SpaceX gets its Starship working. That's the quiet race happening in the background. Insiders say Jeff Bezos is personally invested in winning this race. Elon Musk may be dreaming about Mars, but Bezos wants to own the moon. And that's all for now.
Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.